Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents JavaScript, the definitive guide. Master the world's most used programming language, 7th edition, by David Flanagan. Narrated by Gabriel Vaughan. Publisher's note. This audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Preface. This book covers the JavaScript language and the JavaScript APIs implemented by web browsers and by Node. I wrote it for those with some prior programming experience who want to learn JavaScript, and also for programmers who already use JavaScript but want to take their understanding to a new level and really master the language. My goal with this book is to document the JavaScript language comprehensively and definitively, and to provide an in-depth introduction to the most important client-side and server-side APIs available to JavaScript programs. As a result, this is a long and detailed book. My hope, however, is that it will reward careful study and that the time you spend listening to it will be easily recouped in the form of higher programming productivity. Previous editions of this book included a comprehensive reference section. I no longer feel that it makes sense to include that material in printed form when it is so quick and easy to find up-to-date reference material online. If you need to look up anything related to core or client-side JavaScript, I recommend you visit the MDN website. And for server-side Node APIs, I recommend you go directly to the source and consult the Node.js reference documentation. Example code. Supplemental material, code examples, exercises, etc. for this book is available for download at oreil.ly/JavaScript_defgd7. This book is here to help you get your job done. In general, if example code is offered with this book, you may use it in your programs and documentation. You do not need to contact us for permission unless you're reproducing a significant portion of the code. For example, writing a program that uses several chunks of code from this book does not require permission. Selling or distributing examples from O'Reilly Books does require permission. Answering a question by citing this book and quoting example code does not require permission. Incorporating a significant amount of example code from this book into your product's documentation does require permission. We appreciate, but generally do not require, attribution. An attribution usually includes the title, author, publisher, and ISBN. For example, JavaScript, The Definitive Guide, 7th edition, by David Flanagan, O'Reilly, copyright 2020, David Flanagan, 978-1-491-95202-3. If you feel your use of code examples falls outside fair use or the permission given, feel free to contact us at permissions@oreilly.com. O'Reilly Online Learning. For more than 40 years, O'Reilly Media has provided technology and business training, knowledge, and insight to help companies succeed. Our unique network of experts and innovators share their knowledge and expertise through books, articles, and our online learning platform. O'Reilly's online learning platform gives you on-demand access to live training courses, in-depth learning paths, interactive coding environments, and a vast collection of text and video from O'Reilly and 200-plus other publishers. For more information, visit O'Reilly.com. Chapter 1. Introduction to JavaScript. JavaScript is the programming language of the web. The overwhelming majority of websites use JavaScript, and all modern web browsers, on desktops, tablets, and phones, include JavaScript interpreters, making JavaScript the most deployed programming language in history. Over the last decade, Node.js has enabled JavaScript programming outside of web browsers. And the dramatic success of Node means that JavaScript is now also the most used programming language among software developers. Whether you're starting from scratch or already using JavaScript professionally, this book will help you master the language. If you are already familiar with other programming languages, it may help you to know that JavaScript is a high-level, dynamic, interpreted programming language that is well-suited to object-oriented and functional programming styles. JavaScript's variables are untyped. Its syntax is loosely based on Java, but the languages are otherwise unrelated. JavaScript derives its first-class functions from Scheme, and its proto-based inheritance from the little-known language Self. But you do not need to know any of those languages or be familiar with those terms to use this book and learn JavaScript. The name JavaScript is quite misleading. Except for a superficial syntactic resemblance, JavaScript is completely different from Java programming language, and JavaScript has long since outgrown its scripting language roots to become a robust and efficient general-purpose language suitable for serious software engineering and projects with huge code bases. To be useful, every language must have a platform or standard library for performing things like basic input and output. The core JavaScript language defines a minimal API for working with numbers, text, arrays, sets, maps, and so on, but does not include any input or output functionality. Input and output, as well as more sophisticated features such as networking, storage, and graphics, are the responsibility of the host environment within which JavaScript is embedded. The original host environment for JavaScript was a web browser, and this is still the most common execution environment for JavaScript code. The web browser environment allows JavaScript code to obtain input from the user's mouse and keyboard and by making HTTP requests. And it allows JavaScript code to display output to the user with HTML and CSS. Since 2010, another host environment has been available for JavaScript code. Instead of constraining JavaScript to work with the APIs provided by a web browser, Node gives JavaScript access to the entire operating system, allowing JavaScript programs to read and write files, send and receive data over the network, and make and serve HTTP requests. Node is a popular choice for implementing web servers and also a convenient tool for writing simple utility scripts as an alternative to shell scripts. Most of this book is focused on the JavaScript language itself. Chapter 11 documents the JavaScript standard library. Chapter 15 introduces the web browser host environment, and Chapter 16 introduces the Node host environment. This book covers low-level fundamentals first, and then builds on those to more advanced and higher-level abstractions. The chapters are intended to be consumed more or less in order, but learning a new programming language is never a linear process, and describing a language is not linear either. Each language feature is related to other features, and this book is full of cross-references, sometimes backward and sometimes forward, to related material. This introductory chapter makes a quick first pass through the language, introducing key features that will make it easier to understand the in-depth treatment in the chapters that follow. If you are already a practicing JavaScript programmer, you can probably skip this chapter, although you might enjoy example 1-1 at the end of the chapter before you move on. JavaScript: names, versions, and modes. JavaScript was created at Netscape in the early days of the web, and technically, JavaScript is a trademark licensed from Sun Microsystems, now Oracle, used to describe Netscape's, now Mozilla's, implementation of the language. Netscape submitted the language for standardization to ECMA, the European Computer Manufacturers Association, And because of trademark issues, the standardized version of the language was stuck with the awkward name ECMA script. In practice, everyone just calls the language JavaScript. This book uses the name ECMA script and the abbreviation ES to refer to the language standard and to versions of that standard. For most of the 2010s, version 5 of the ECMA script standard has been supported by all web browsers. This book treats ES5 as the compatibility baseline and no longer discusses earlier versions of the language. ES6 was released in 2015 and added major new features, including class and module syntax, that changed JavaScript from a scripting language into a serious, general-purpose language suitable for large-scale software engineering. Since ES6, the ECMA script specification has moved to a yearly release cadence, and versions of the language, ES2016, ES2017, ES2018, ES2019, and ES2020, are now identified by year of release. As JavaScript evolved, the language designers attempted to correct flaws in the early, pre-ES5, versions. In order to maintain backward compatibility, it is not possible to remove legacy features, no matter how flawed. But in ES5 and later, programs can opt in to JavaScript's strict mode, in which a number of early language mistakes have been corrected. The mechanism for opting in is the Use Strict directive, described in section 5.6.3. That section also summarizes the difference between legacy JavaScript and strict JavaScript. In ES6 and later, the use of new language features often implicitly invokes strict mode. For example, if you use the ES6 class keyword or create an ES6 module, then all the code within the class or module is automatically strict, and the old, flawed features are not available in those contexts. This book will cover the legacy features of JavaScript, but is careful to point out that they are not available in strict mode. 1.1. Exploring JavaScript. When learning a new programming language, it's important to try the examples in the book, then modify them, and try them again to test your understanding of the language. To do that, you need a JavaScript interpreter. The easiest way to try out a few lines of JavaScript is to open up the web development tools in your web browser with F12, Control-Shift-I, or Command-Option-I, and select the Console tab. You can then type code at the prompt and see the results as you type. Browser developer tools often appear as panes at the bottom or right of the browser window, but you can usually detach them as separate windows, as pictured in Figure 1.1, which can be found in the accompanying bonus material, which is often quite convenient. Another way to try out JavaScript code is to download and install Node from nodejs.org. Once Node is installed on your system, you can simply open a terminal window and type Node to begin an interactive JavaScript session like this one. 1.2. Hello World. When you are ready to start experimenting with longer chunks of code, these line-by-line interactive environments may no longer be suitable, and you will probably prefer to write your code in a text editor. From there, you can copy and paste to the JavaScript console or into a Node session. Or you can save your code to a file. The traditional file name extension for JavaScript code is .js, and then run that file of JavaScript code with Node. If you use Node in a non-interactive manner like this, it won't automatically print out the value of all the code you run, so you'll have to do that yourself. You can use the function console.log to display text and other JavaScript values in your terminal window or in a browser's developer tools console. So, for example, if you create a hello.js file containing this line of code and execute the file with node hello.js, you'll see the message "Hello World" printed out. If you want to see that same message printed out in the JavaScript console of a web browser, create a new file named hello.html and put this text in it. Then load hello.html into your web browser using a file:// url like this one. Open the Developer Tools window to see the greeting in the console. 1.3, a tour of JavaScript. This section presents a quick introduction, through code examples, to the JavaScript language. After this introductory chapter, we dive into JavaScript at the lowest level. Chapter 2 explains things like JavaScript comments, semicolons, and the Unicode character set. Chapter 3 starts to get more interesting. It explains JavaScript variables and the values you can assign to those variables. Here's some sample code to demonstrate the highlights of those two chapters. Two other very important types that JavaScript programs can manipulate are objects and arrays. These are the subjects of chapters 6 and 7, but they are so important that we'll discuss them many times before you reach those chapters. The syntax illustrated here for listing array elements within square braces or mapping object property names to prevent values inside curly braces is known as an initializer expression, and it is just one of the topics of chapter 4. An expression is a phrase of JavaScript that can be evaluated to produce a value. For example, the use of period and square brackets to refer to the value of an object property or array element is an expression. One of the most common ways to form expressions in JavaScript is to use operators. If JavaScript expressions are like phrases, then JavaScript statements are like full sentences. Statements are the topic of Chapter 5. Roughly, an expression is something that computes a value but doesn't do anything. It doesn't alter the program state in any way. Statements, on the other hand, don't have a value, but they do alter the state. We've discussed variable declarations and assignment statements. The other broad category of statement is control structures, such as conditionals and loops. We will discuss some examples coming up after we cover functions. A function is a named and parameterized block of JavaScript code that you define once, and you can then invoke over and over again. Functions aren't covered formally until Chapter 8, but like objects and arrays, you'll see them many times before you get to that chapter. Here are some simple examples. In ES6 and later, there is a shorthand syntax for defining functions. This concise syntax uses equals greater than to separate the argument list from the function body. So functions defined this way are known as arrow functions. Arrow functions are most commonly used when you want to pass an unnamed function as an argument to another function. The preceding code looks like this when rewritten to use arrow functions. When we use functions with objects, we get methods. Now, as promised, here are some functions whose bodies demonstrate common JavaScript control structure statements. JavaScript supports an object-oriented programming style, but is significantly different than classical object-oriented programming languages. Chapter 9 covers object-oriented programming in JavaScript in detail with lots of examples. Here is a very simple example that demonstrates how to define a JavaScript class to represent 2D geometric points. Objects that are instances of this class have a single method, named distance, that computes the distance of the point from the origin. This introductory tour of JavaScript's fundamental syntax and capabilities ends here, but the book continues with self-contained chapters that cover additional features of the language. Chapter 10, Modules, discusses how JavaScript code in one file or script can use JavaScript functions and classes defined in other files or scripts. Chapter 11, the JavaScript Standard Library, covers the built-in functions and classes that are available to all JavaScript programs. This includes important data structures like maps and sets, a regular expression class for textual pattern matching, functions for serializing JavaScript data structures, and much more. Chapter 12, Iterators and Generators, explains how the for of loop works and how you can make your own classes iterable with for of. It also covers generator functions and the yield statement. Chapter 13, Asynchronous JavaScript. This chapter is an in-depth exploration of asynchronous programming in JavaScript, covering callbacks and events, promise-based APIs, and the async and await keywords. Although the core JavaScript language is not asynchronous, asynchronous APIs are the default in both web browsers and Node, and this chapter explains the techniques for working with those APIs. Chapter 14, Metaprogramming, introduces a number of advanced features of JavaScript that may be of interest to programmers writing libraries of code for other JavaScript programmers to use. Chapter 15, JavaScript in Web Browsers, introduces the web browser host environment, explains how web browsers execute JavaScript code, and covers the most important of the many APIs defined by web browsers. This is by far the longest chapter in the book. Chapter 16, Server-Side JavaScript with Node, introduces the Node host environment, covering the fundamental programming model and the data structures and APIs that are most important to understand. Chapter 17, JavaScript Tools and Extensions, covers tools and language extensions that are worth knowing about because they are widely used and may make you a more productive programmer. Comment syntax in code examples. You may have noticed in the preceding code that some of the comments begin with an arrow, equals sign, greater than sign. These indicate the value produced by the code before the comment and are my attempt to emulate an interactive JavaScript environment like a web browser console in a printed book. Those double forward slash equal sign, greater than sign comments also serve as an assertion, and I've written a tool that tests the code and verifies that it produces the value specified in the comment. This should help, I hope, to reduce errors in the book. There are two related styles of comment slash assertion. If you see a comment of the form double forward slash A double equals 42, it means that after the code before the comment runs, the variable A will have the value 42. If you see a comment of the form double forward slash exclamation mark, it means that the code on the line before the comment throws an exception, and the rest of the comment after the exclamation mark usually explains what kind of exception is thrown. You'll see these comments used throughout the book. 1.4. Example, Character Frequency Histograms. This chapter concludes with a short but non-trivial JavaScript program. Example 1-1 is a Node program that reads text from standard input, computes a character frequency histogram from that text, and then prints out the histogram. You could invoke the program like this to analyze the character frequency of its own source code. This example uses a number of advanced JavaScript features and is intended to demonstrate what real-world JavaScript programs can look like. You should not expect to understand all the code yet, but be assured that all of it will be explained in the chapters that follow. Example 1-1. Computing character frequency histograms with JavaScript. 1.5. Summary. This book explains JavaScript from the bottom up. This means that we start with low-level details like comments, identifiers, variables, and types, then build to expressions, statements, objects, and functions, and then cover high-level language abstractions like classes and modules. I take the word definitive in the title of this book seriously, and the coming chapters explain the language at a level of detail that may feel off-putting at first. True mastery of JavaScript requires an understanding of the details, however, and I hope that you will make the time to listen to this book from start to finish. If you find yourself feeling bogged down in a section, simply skip to the next. You can come back and master the details once you have a working knowledge of the language as a whole. Chapter 2. Lexical Structure. The lexical structure of a programming language is the set of elementary rules that specifies how you write programs in that language. It is the lowest level syntax of a language. It specifies what variable names look like, the delimiter characters for comments, and how one program statement is separated from the next, for example. This short chapter documents the lexical structure of JavaScript. It covers case sensitivity, spaces and line breaks, comments, literals, identifiers and reserved words, Unicode, optional semicolons. 2.1. The text of a JavaScript program. JavaScript is a case-sensitive language. This means that language keywords, variables, function names, and other identifiers must always be typed with a consistent capitalization of letters. The while keyword, for example, must be typed lowercase while, not capital W while, or all caps while. Similarly, lowercase online, capital O online, capital O, capital L online, and all caps online are four distinct variable names. JavaScript ignores spaces that appear between tokens in programs. For the most part, JavaScript also ignores line breaks, but see section 2.6 for an exception. Because you can use spaces and new lines freely in your programs, you can format and indent your programs in a neat and consistent way that makes the code easy to read and understand. In addition to the regular space character, \u0020, JavaScript also recognizes tabs, assorted ASCII control characters, and various Unicode space characters as white space. JavaScript recognizes new lines, carriage returns, and a carriage return slash line feed sequence as line terminators. 2.2. Comments. JavaScript supports two styles of comments. Any text between a double forward slash and the end of a line is treated as a comment and is ignored by JavaScript. Any text between the characters forward slash asterisk and asterisk forward slash is also treated as a comment. These comments may span multiple lines, but may not be nested. The upcoming lines of code are all legal JavaScript comments. 2.3. Literals. A literal is a data value that appears directly in a program. Here are all literals. Complete details on numeric and string literals appear in Chapter 3. 2.4. Identifiers and reserved words. An identifier is simply a name. In JavaScript, identifiers are used to name constants, variables, properties, functions, and classes, and to provide labels for certain loops in JavaScript code. A JavaScript identifier must begin with a letter, an underscore, or a dollar sign. Subsequent characters can be letters, digits, underscores, or dollar signs. Digits are not allowed as the first character so that JavaScript can easily distinguish identifiers from numbers. These are all legal identifiers. Like any language, JavaScript reserves certain identifiers for use by the language itself. These reserved words cannot be used as regular identifiers. They are listed in the next section. 2.4.1 Reserved Words. The upcoming words are part of the JavaScript language. Many of these, such as if, while, and for, are reserved keywords that must not be used as the names of constants, variables, functions, or classes, though they can all be used as the names of properties within an object. Others, such as from, of, get, and set, are used in limited contexts with no syntactic ambiguity and are perfectly legal as identifiers. Still other keywords, such as let, can't be fully reserved in order to retain backward compatibility with older programs. And so, there are complex rules that govern when they can be used as identifiers and when they cannot. Let can be used as a variable name if declared with var outside of a class, for example, but not if declared inside a class or with const. The simplest course is to avoid using any of these words as identifiers, except for from, set, and target, which are safe to use and are already in common use. As, async, await, break, case, catch, class, const, continue, debugger, default, delete, do, else, export, extends, false, finally, for, from, function, get, if, import, in, instance of, let, new, null, of, return, set, static, super, switch, target, this, throw, true, try, type of, var, void, while, with, yield. JavaScript also reserves or restricts the use of certain keywords that are not currently used by the language, but that might be used in future versions. Enum, implements, interface, package, private, protected, public. For historical reasons, arguments and eval are not allowed as identifiers in certain circumstances and are best avoided entirely. 2.5. Unicode. JavaScript programs are written using the Unicode character set, and you can use any Unicode characters in strings and comments. For portability and ease of editing, it is common to use only ASCII letters and digits in identifiers. But this is a programming convention only, and the language allows Unicode letters, digits, and ideographs, but not emojis, in identifiers. This means that programmers can use mathematic symbols and words from non-English languages as constants and variables. 2.5.1 Unicode escape sequences. Some computer hardware and software cannot display, input, or correctly process the full set of Unicode characters. To support programmers and systems using older technology, JavaScript defines escape sequences that allow us to write Unicode characters using only ASCII characters. These Unicode escapes begin with the characters backslash U and are either followed by exactly four hexadecimal digits, using uppercase or lowercase letters A through F, or by 1 to 6 hexadecimal digits enclosed within curly braces. These Unicode escapes may appear in JavaScript string literals, regular expression literals, and identifiers, but not in language keywords. The Unicode escape for the character acute accented E, for example, is backslash U00 capital E9. Here are three different ways to write a variable name that includes this character. Early versions of JavaScript only supported the 4-digit escape sequence. The version with curly braces was introduced in ES6 to better support Unicode code points that require more than 16 bits, such as emoji. Unicode escapes may also appear in comments, but since comments are ignored, they are simply treated as ASCII characters in that context and not interpreted as Unicode. 2.5.2 Unicode normalization. If you use non-ASCII characters in your JavaScript programs, you must be aware that Unicode allows more than one way of encoding the same character. The string acute accented E, for example, can be encoded as the single Unicode character \U00E9, or as a regular ASCII E, followed by the acute accent combining mark \U0301. These two encodings typically look exactly the same when displayed by a text editor, but they have different binary encodings, meaning that they are considered different by JavaScript, which can lead to very confusing programs. The Unicode standard defines the preferred encoding for all characters and specifies a normalization procedure to convert text to a canonical form suitable for comparisons. JavaScript assumes that the source code it is interpreting has already been normalized and does not do any normalization on its own. If you plan to use Unicode characters in your JavaScript programs, you should ensure that your editor or some other tool performs Unicode normalization of your source code to prevent you from ending up with different but visually indistinguishable identifiers. 2.6. Optional semicolons. Like many programming languages, JavaScript uses the semicolon to separate statements from one another. This is important for making the meaning of your code clear. Without a separator, the end of one statement might appear to be the beginning of the next, or vice versa. In JavaScript, you can usually omit the semicolon between two statements if those statements are written on separate lines. You can also omit a semicolon at the end of a program, or if the next token in the program is a closing curly brace. Many JavaScript programmers, and the code in this book, use semicolons to explicitly mark the ends of statements, even where they are not required. Another style is to omit semicolons whenever possible, using them only in the few situations that require them. Whichever style you choose, there are a few details you should understand about optional semicolons in JavaScript. Consider the next code. Since the two statements appear on separate lines, the first semicolon could be omitted. Written as follows, however, the first semicolon is required. Note that JavaScript does not treat every line break as a semicolon. It usually treats line breaks as semicolons only if it can't parse the code without adding an implicit semicolon. More formally, and with three exceptions described a bit later, JavaScript treats a line break as a semicolon if the next non-space character cannot be interpreted as a continuation of the current statement. Consider this code. JavaScript interprets this code like this. JavaScript treats the first line break as a semicolon because it cannot parse the code let a without a semicolon. The second a could stand alone as the statement a semicolon, but JavaScript does not treat the second line break as a semicolon because it can continue parsing the longer statement, a=3. These statement termination rules lead to some surprising cases. This code looks like two separate statements separated with a new line. But the parentheses on the second line of code can be interpreted as a function invocation of f from the first line, and JavaScript interprets the code like this. More likely than not, this is not the interpretation intended by the author of the code. In order to work as two separate statements, an explicit semicolon is required in this case. In general, if a statement begins with open parenthesis, open square bracket, forward slash, plus sign, or minus sign, there is a chance that it can be interpreted as a continuation of the statement before. Statements beginning with forward slash, plus sign, and minus sign are quite rare in practice, but statements beginning with open parenthesis and open square bracket are not uncommon at all, at least in some styles of JavaScript programming. Some programmers like to put a defensive semicolon at the beginning of any such statement so that it will continue to work correctly even if the statement before it is modified and a previously terminating semicolon removed. There are three exceptions to the general rule that JavaScript interprets line breaks as semicolons when it cannot parse the second line as a continuation of the statement on the first line. The first exception involves the return, throw, yield, break, and continue statements. These statements often stand alone, but they are sometimes followed by an identifier or expression. If a line break appears after any of these words, before any other tokens, JavaScript will always interpret that line break as a semicolon. For example, if you write, JavaScript assumes you meant, however, you probably meant, this means that you must not insert a line break between return, break, or continue, and the expression that follows the keyword. If you do insert a line break, your code is likely to fail in a non-obvious way that is difficult to debug. The second exception involves the double plus sign and double minus sign operators, section 4.8. These operators can be prefix operators that appear before an expression or postfix operators that appear after an expression. If you want to use either of these operators as postfix operators, they must appear on the same line as the expression they apply to. The third exception involves functions defined using concise arrow syntax. The equals sign, greater than sign, arrow itself must appear on the same line as the parameter list. 2.7. Summary. This chapter has discussed how JavaScript programs are written at the lowest level. The next chapter takes us one step higher and introduces the primitive types and values, numbers, strings, and so on, that serve as the basic units of computation for JavaScript programs. Chapter 3. Types, Values, and Variables. Computer programs work by manipulating values, such as the number 3.14 or the text Hello World. The kinds of values that can be represented and manipulated in a programming language are known as types, and one of the most fundamental characteristics of a programming language is the set of types it supports. When a program needs to retain a value for future use, it assigns the value to, or stores the value in, a variable. Variables have names, and they allow use of those names in our programs to refer to values. The way that variables work is another fundamental characteristic of any programming language. This chapter explains types, values, and variables in JavaScript. It begins with an overview and some definitions. 3.1. Overview and definitions. JavaScript types can be divided into two categories, primitive types and object types. JavaScript's primitive types include numbers, strings of text, known as strings, and Boolean truth values, known as Booleans. A significant portion of this chapter is dedicated to a detailed explanation of the numeric, section 3.2, and string, section 3.3, types in JavaScript. Booleans are covered in section 3.4. The special JavaScript values null and undefined are primitive values, but they are not numbers, strings, or Booleans. Each value is typically considered to be the sole member of its own special type. Section 3.5 has more about null and undefined. ES6 adds a new special purpose type, known as symbol, that enables the definition of language extensions without harming backward compatibility. Symbols are covered briefly in Section 3.6. Any JavaScript value that is not a number, a string, a Boolean, a symbol, null, or undefined is an object. An object, that is, a member of the type object, is a collection of properties, where each property has a name and a value, either a primitive value or another object. One very special object, the global object, is covered in Section 3.7, but more general and detailed coverage of objects is in Chapter 6. An ordinary JavaScript object is an unordered collection of named values. The language also defines a special kind of object, known as an array, that represents an ordered collection of numbered values. The JavaScript language includes special syntax for working with arrays, and arrays have some special behavior that distinguishes them from ordinary objects. Arrays are the subject of Chapter 7. In addition to basic objects and arrays, JavaScript defines a number of other useful object types. A set object represents a set of values. A map object represents a mapping from keys to values. Various typed array types facilitate operations on arrays of bytes and other binary data. The regexp type represents textual patterns and enables sophisticated matching, searching, and replacing operations on strings. The date type represents dates and times and supports rudimentary date arithmetic. Error and its subtypes represent errors that can arise when executing JavaScript code. All of these types are covered in Chapter 11. JavaScript differs from more static languages in that functions and classes are not just part of the language syntax. They are themselves values that can be manipulated by JavaScript programs. Like any JavaScript value that is not a primitive value, functions and classes are a specialized kind of object. They are covered in detail in chapters 8 and 9. The JavaScript interpreter performs automatic garbage collection for memory management. This means that a JavaScript programmer generally does not need to worry about destruction or deallocation of objects or other values. When a value is no longer reachable, when a program no longer has any way to refer to it, the interpreter knows it can never be used again and automatically reclaims the memory it was occupying. JavaScript programmers do sometimes need to take care to ensure that values do not inadvertently remain reachable, and therefore non-reclaimable, longer than necessary. JavaScript supports an object-oriented programming style. Loosely, this means that rather than having globally defined functions to operate on values of various types, the types themselves define methods for working with values. To sort the elements of an array, A, for example, we don't pass A to a sort function. Instead, we invoke the sort method of A. Method definition is covered in Chapter 9. Technically, it is only JavaScript objects that have methods. But numbers, strings, Boolean, and symbol values behave as if they have methods. In JavaScript, null and undefined are the only values that methods cannot be invoked on. JavaScript's object types are mutable, and its primitive types are immutable. A value of a mutable type can change. A JavaScript program can change the values of object properties and array elements. Numbers, Booleans, symbols, null, and undefined are immutable. It doesn't even make sense to talk about changing the value of a number, for example. Strings can be thought of as arrays of characters, and you might expect them to be mutable. In JavaScript, however, strings are immutable. You can access the text at any index of a string, but JavaScript provides no way to alter the text of an existing string. The differences between mutable and immutable values are explored further in Section 3.8. JavaScript liberally converts values from one type to another. If a program expects a string, for example, and you give it a number, it will automatically convert the number to a string for you. And if you use a non-Boolean value, where a Boolean is expected, JavaScript will convert accordingly. The rules for value conversion are explained in Section 3.9. JavaScript's liberal value conversion rules affect its definition of equality, and the double equals equality operator performs type conversions as described in Section 3.9.1. In practice, however, the double equals equality operator is deprecated in favor of the strict equality operator, triple equals, which does not type conversions. See Section 4.9.1 for more about both operators. Constants and variables allow you to use names to refer to values in your programs. Constants are declared with const, and variables are declared with let, or with var in older JavaScript code. JavaScript constants and variables are untyped. Declarations do not specify what kind of values will be assigned. Variable declaration and assignment are covered in Section 3.10. As you can tell from this long introduction, this is a wide-ranging chapter that explains many fundamental details about how data is represented and manipulated in JavaScript. We'll begin by diving right into the details of JavaScript numbers and text. 3.2. Numbers. JavaScript's primary numeric type, number, is used to represent integers and to approximate real numbers. JavaScript represents numbers using the 64-bit floating point format defined by the IEEE 754 standard. This is the format for numbers of type double in Java, C++, and most modern programming languages, which means it can represent numbers as large as plus or minus 1.797693134862315 times 10 to the 308th power, and as small as plus or minus 5 times 10 to the negative 324th power. The JavaScript number format allows you to exactly represent all integers between negative 9 quadrillion, 7 trillion, 199 billion, 254 million, 740,992 times negative 2 to the 53rd power, and 9 quadrillion, 7 trillion, 199 billion, 254 million, 740,992 times 2 to the 53rd power, inclusive. If you use integer values larger than this, you may lose precision in the trailing digits. Note, however, that certain operations in JavaScript, such as array indexing and the bitwise operators described in Chapter 4, are performed with 32-bit integers. If you need to exactly represent larger integers, see Section 3.2.5. When a number appears directly in a JavaScript program, it's called a numeric literal. JavaScript supports numeric literals in several formats, as described in the upcoming sections. Note that any numeric literal can be preceded by a minus sign to make the number negative. 3.2.1. Integer literals. In a JavaScript program, a base 10 integer is written as a sequence of digits. For example, in addition to base 10 integer literals, JavaScript recognizes hexadecimal, base 16, values. A hexadecimal literal begins with 0x or 0 capital X, followed by a string of hexadecimal digits. A hexadecimal digit is one of the digits 0 through 9, or the letters A, or capital A, through F, or capital F, which represent values 10 through 15. Here are examples of hexadecimal integer literals. In ES6 and later, you can also express integers in binary, base 2, or octal, base 8, using the prefixes 0b and 0o, or 0 capital B and 0 capital O, instead of 0x. 3.2.2, floating point literals. Floating point literals can have a decimal point. They use the traditional syntax for real numbers. A real value is represented as the integral part of the number, followed by a decimal point and the fractional part of the number. Floating point literals may also be represented using exponential notation. A real number followed by the letter E, or capital E, followed by an optional plus or minus sign, followed by an integer exponent. This notation represents the real number multiplied by 10 to the point of the exponent. More succinctly, the syntax is, for example, separators in numeric literals. You can use underscores within numeric literals to break long literals up into chunks that are easier to understand. At the time of this writing in early 2020, underscores in numeric literals are not yet formally standardized as part of JavaScript, but they are in the advanced stages of the standardization process and are implemented by all major browsers and by Node. 3.2.3. Arithmetic in JavaScript. JavaScript programs work with numbers using the arithmetic operators that the language provides. These include plus for addition, minus for subtraction, asterisk for multiplication, forward slash for division, and percent sign for modulo, remainder after division. ES 2016 adds double asterisk for exponentiation. Full details on these and other operators can be found in Chapter 4. In addition to these basic arithmetic operators, JavaScript supports more complex mathematical operations through a set of functions and constants defined as properties of the math object. ES6 defines more functions on the math object. Arithmetic in JavaScript does not raise errors in cases of overflow, underflow, or division by zero. When the result of a numeric operation is larger than the largest representable number, overflow, the result is a special infinity value, infinity. Similarly, when the absolute value of a negative value becomes larger than the absolute value of the largest representable negative number, the result is negative infinity, negative infinity. The infinite values behave as you would expect. Adding, subtracting, multiplying, or dividing them by anything results in an infinite value, possibly with the sign reversed. Underflow occurs when the result of a numeric operation is closer to zero than the smallest representable number. In this case, JavaScript returns zero. If underflow occurs from a negative number, JavaScript returns a special value known as negative zero. This value is almost completely indistinguishable from regular zero, and JavaScript programmers rarely need to detect it. Division by zero is not an error in JavaScript. It simply returns infinity or negative infinity. There is one exception, however. Zero divided by zero does not have a well-defined value, and the result of this operation is the special, not-a-number value, nan. Nan also arises if you attempt to divide infinity by infinity, take the square root of a negative number, or use arithmetic operators with non-numeric operands that cannot be converted to numbers. JavaScript predefines global constants, infinity and nan, to hold the positive infinity and not a number value, and these values are also available as properties of the number object. The not-a-number value has one unusual feature in JavaScript. It does not compare equal to any other value, including itself. This means that you can't write x triple equals nan to determine whether the value of a variable x is nan. Instead, you must write x exclamation mark equals x or number dot is nan open parenthesis x close parenthesis. Those expressions will be true if and only if x has the same value as the global constant nan. The global function isNan is similar to number.isNan. It returns true if its argument is nan, or if that argument is a non-numeric value that cannot be converted to a number. The related function number.isFinite returns true if its argument is a number other than nan, infinity, or negative infinity. The global isFinite function returns true if its argument is, or can be converted to, a finite number. The negative zero value is also somewhat unusual. It compares equal, even using JavaScript's strict equality test, to positive zero, which means that the two values are almost indistinguishable, except when used as a divisor. 3.2.4 Binary floating point and rounding errors. There are infinitely many real numbers, but only a finite number of them, 18 quintillion, 437 quadrillion, 736 trillion, 874 billion, 454 million, 810,627 to be exact, can be represented exactly by the JavaScript floating point format. This means that when you're working with real numbers in JavaScript, the representation of the number will often be an approximation of the actual number. The IEEE 754 floating point representation used by JavaScript, and just about every other modern programming language, is a binary representation, which can exactly represent fractions like 1/2, 1/8, and 1/1024. Unfortunately, the fractions we use most commonly, especially when performing financial calculations, are decimal fractions, 1/10, 1/100, and so on. Binary floating point representations cannot exactly represent numbers as simple as 0.1. JavaScript numbers have plenty of precision and can approximate 0.1 very closely. But the fact that this number cannot be represented exactly can lead to problems. Consider this code. Because of rounding error, the difference between the approximations of 0.3 and 0.2 is not exactly the same as the difference between the approximations of 0.2 and 0.1. It is important to understand that this problem is not specific to JavaScript. It affects any programming language that uses binary floating point numbers. Also, note that the values x and y in the code here are very close to each other and to the correct value. The computed values are adequate for almost any purpose. The problem only arises when we attempt to compare values for equality. If these floating point approximations are problematic for your programs, consider using scaled integers. For example, you might manipulate monetary values as integer cents rather than fractional dollars. 3.2.5 Arbitrary precision integers with big int. One of the newest features of JavaScript, defined in ES 2020, is a new numeric type known as big int. As of early 2020, it has been implemented in Chrome, Firefox, Edge, and Node, and there is an implementation in progress in Safari. As the name implies, big int is a numeric type whose values are integers. The type was added to JavaScript mainly to allow the representation of 64-bit integers, which are required for compatibility with many other programming languages and APIs. But big int values can have thousands or even millions of digits, should you have need to work with numbers that large. Note, however, that big int implementations are not suitable for cryptography because they do not attempt to prevent timing attacks. Big int literals are written as a string of digits followed by a lowercase letter n. By default, they are in base 10, but you can use the 0b, 0o, and 0x prefixes for binary, octal, and hexadecimal big ints. You can use big int as a function for converting regular JavaScript numbers or strings to big int values. Arithmetic with big int values works like arithmetic with regular JavaScript numbers, except that division drops any remainder and rounds down towards zero. Although the standard plus sign, minus sign, asterisk, forward slash, percent sign, and double asterisk operators work with big int, it is important to understand that you may not mix operands of type big int with regular number operands. This may seem confusing at first, but there is a good reason for it. If one numeric type was more general than the other, it would be easy to define arithmetic on mixed operands to simply return a value of the more general type. But neither type is more general than the other. Big int can represent extraordinarily large values, making it more general than regular numbers. But big int can only represent integers, making the regular JavaScript number type more general. There is no way around this problem, so JavaScript sidesteps it by simply not allowing mixed operands to the arithmetic operators. Comparison operators, by contrast, do work with mixed numeric types. But see section 3.9.1 for more about the difference between double equals and triple equals. The bitwise operators, described in section 4.8.3, generally work with big int operands. None of the functions of the math object accept big int operands, however. 3.2.6, dates and times. JavaScript defines a simple date class for representing and manipulating the numbers that represent dates and times. JavaScript dates are objects, but they also have a numeric representation as a timestamp that specifies the number of elapsed milliseconds since January 1, 1970. The date class and its methods are covered in detail in section 11.4, but we will discuss objects again in section 3.9.3 when we examine the details of JavaScript type conversions. 3.3. Text. The JavaScript type for representing text is the string. A string is an immutable ordered sequence of 16-bit values, each of which typically represents a Unicode character. The length of a string is the number of 16-bit values it contains. JavaScript's strings, and its arrays, use zero-based indexing. The first 16-bit value is at position 0, the second at position 1, and so on. The empty string is the string of length 0. JavaScript does not have a special type that represents a single element of a string. To represent a single 16-bit value, simply use a string that has a length of 1. Characters, code points, and JavaScript strings. JavaScript uses the UTF-16 encoding of the Unicode character set, and JavaScript strings are sequences of unsigned 16-bit values. The most commonly used Unicode characters, those from the basic multilingual plane, have code points that fit in 16 bits and can be represented by one element of a string. Unicode characters whose code points do not fit in 16 bits are encoded using the rules of UTF-16 as a sequence, known as a surrogate pair, of two 16-bit values. This means that a JavaScript string of length 2, two 16-bit values, might represent only a single Unicode character. Most string manipulation methods defined by JavaScript operate on 16-bit values, not characters. They do not treat surrogate pairs specially. They perform no normalization of the string and don't even ensure that a string is well-formed UTF-16. In ES6, however, strings are iterable. And if you use the for of loop or triple dot operator with a string, it will iterate the actual characters of the string, not the 16-bit values. 3.3.1 String literals. To include a string in a JavaScript program, simply enclose the characters of the string within a matched pair of single or double quotes or backticks. Double quote characters and backticks may be contained within strings delimited by single quote characters, and similarly for strings delimited by double quotes and backticks. Here are examples of string literals. Strings delimited with backticks are a feature of ES6 and allow JavaScript expressions to be embedded within or interpolated into the string literal. This expression interpolation syntax is covered in section 3.3.4. The original versions of JavaScript required string literals to be written on a single line, and it is common to see JavaScript code that creates long strings by concatenating single-line strings with the plus sign operator. As of ES5, however, you can break a string literal across multiple lines by ending each line, but the last, with a backslash. Neither the backslash nor the line terminator that follow it are part of the string literal. If you need to include a new line character in a single quoted or double quoted string literal, use the character sequence backslash n, documented in the next section. The ES6 backtick syntax allows strings to be broken across multiple lines, and in this case, the line terminators are part of the string literal. Note that when you use single quotes to delimit your strings, you must be careful with English contractions and possessives, such as can't and O'Reilly's. Since the apostrophe is the same as the single quote character, you must use the backslash character to escape any apostrophes that appear in single quoted strings. Escapes are explained in the next section. In client-side JavaScript programming, JavaScript code may contain strings of HTML code, and HTML code may contain strings of JavaScript code. Like JavaScript, HTML uses either single or double quotes to delimit its strings. Thus, when combining JavaScript and HTML, it is a good idea to use one style of quotes for JavaScript and the other style for HTML. In the next example, the string thank you is single quoted within a JavaScript expression, which is then double quoted within an HTML event handler attribute. 3.3.2 Escape sequences in string literals. The backslash character has a special purpose in JavaScript strings. Combined with the character that follows it, it represents a character that is not otherwise representable within the string. For example, backslash n is an escape sequence that represents a new line character. Another example, mentioned earlier, is the backslash single quote character escape, which represents the single quote or apostrophe character. This escape sequence is useful when you need to include an apostrophe in a string literal that is contained within single quotes. You can see why these are called escape sequences. The backslash allows you to escape from the usual interpretation of the single quote character. Instead of using it to mark the end of the string, you use it as an apostrophe. Table 3-1, which can be found in the accompanying bonus material, lists the JavaScript escape sequences and the characters they represent. Three escape sequences are generic and can be used to represent any character by specifying its Unicode character code as a hexadecimal number. For example, the sequence \X A9 represents the copyright symbol, which has the Unicode encoding given by the hexadecimal number A9. Similarly, the \U escape represents an arbitrary Unicode character specified by 4 hexadecimal digits or 1 to 5 digits when the digits are enclosed in curly braces. \U03C0 represents the character pi, for example, and \U(1F600) close curly brace represents the grinning face emoji. If the \ character precedes any character other than those in table 3-1, the \ is simply ignored, although future versions of the language may, of course, define new escape sequences. For example, \\numbersign is the same as number sign. Finally, as noted earlier, ES5 allows a \ before a line break to break a string literal across multiple lines. 3.3.3. Working with strings. One of the built-in features of JavaScript is the ability to concatenate strings. If you use the plus sign operator with numbers, it adds them. But if you use this operator on strings, it joins them by appending the second to the first. For example, strings can be compared with the standard triple equals equality and exclamation mark double equals inequality operators. Two strings are equal if and only if they consist of exactly the same sequence of 16-bit values. Strings can also be compared with the less than sign, less than equals sign, greater than sign, and greater than equals sign operators. String comparison is done simply by comparing the 16-bit values. To determine the length of a string, the number of 16-bit values it contains, use the length property of the string. In addition to this length property, JavaScript provides a rich API for working with strings. Remember that strings are immutable in JavaScript. Methods like replace and toUpperCase return new strings. They do not modify the string on which they are invoked. Strings can also be treated like read-only arrays, and you can access individual characters, 16-bit values, from a string using square brackets instead of the charAt method. 3.3.4. Template literals. In ES6 and later, string literals can be delimited with backticks. This is more than just another string literal syntax, however, because these template literals can include arbitrary JavaScript expressions. The final value of a string literal in backticks is computed by evaluating any included expressions, converting the values of those expressions to strings, and combining those computed strings with the literal characters within the backticks. Everything between the $ open curly brace and the matching close curly brace is interpreted as a JavaScript expression. Everything outside the curly braces is normal string literal text. The expression inside the braces is evaluated and then converted to a string and inserted into the template, replacing the $, the curly braces, and everything in between them. A template literal may include any number of expressions. It can use any of the escape characters that normal strings can, and it can span any number of lines, with no special escaping required. The next template literal includes 4 JavaScript expressions, a Unicode escape sequence, and at least 4 new lines. The expression values may include new lines as well. The \ at the end of the first line here escapes the initial new line, so that the resulting string begins with the Unicode heavy ballot X character, / U2718, rather than a new line. Tagged template literals. A powerful but less commonly used feature of template literals is that if a function name, or tag, comes right before the opening backtick, then the text and values of the expressions within the template literal are passed to the function. The value of this tagged template literal is the return value of the function. This could be used, for example, to apply HTML or SQL escaping to the values before substituting them into the text. ES6 has one built-in tag function, string.raw. It returns the text within backticks without any processing of / escapes. Note that even though the tag portion of a tagged template literal is a function, there are no parentheses used in its invocation. In this very specific case, the backtick characters replace the open and close parentheses. The ability to define your own template tag functions is a powerful feature of JavaScript. These functions do not need to return strings, and they can be used like constructors, as if defining a new literal syntax for the language. We'll discuss an example in section 14.5. 3.3.5, pattern matching. JavaScript defines a data type known as a regular expression, or regexp, for describing and matching patterns in strings of text. Regexps are not one of the fundamental data types in JavaScript, but they have a literal syntax like numbers and strings do, so they sometimes seem like they are fundamental. The grammar of regular expression literals is complex, and the API they define is non-trivial. They are documented in detail in section 11.3. Because regexps are powerful and commonly used for text processing, however, this section provides a brief overview. Text between a pair of slashes constitutes a regular expression literal. The second slash in the pair can also be followed by one or more letters, which modify the meaning of the pattern. For example, regexp objects define a number of useful methods, and strings also have methods that accept regexp arguments. For example, 3.4, Boolean values. A Boolean value represents truth or falsehood, on or off, yes or no. There are only two possible values of this type. The reserved words true and false evaluate to these two values. Boolean values are generally the result of comparisons you make in your JavaScript programs. For example, this code tests to see whether the value of the variable a is equal to the number 4. If it is, the result of this comparison is the Boolean value true. If a is not equal to 4, the result of the comparison is false. Boolean values are commonly used in JavaScript control structures. For example, the if-else statement in JavaScript performs one action if a Boolean value is true, and another action if the value is false. You usually combine a comparison that creates a Boolean value directly with a statement that uses it. The result looks like this. This code checks whether A equals 4. If so, it adds 1 to B. Otherwise, it adds 1 to A. As we'll discuss in section 3.9, any JavaScript value can be converted to a Boolean value. The next values convert to, and therefore work like, false. All other values, including all objects and arrays, convert to and work like true. False and the six values that convert to it are sometimes called falsy values, and all other values are called truthy. Anytime JavaScript expects a Boolean value, a falsy value works like false, and a truthy value works like true. As an example, suppose that the variable O either holds an object or the value null. You can test explicitly to see if O is non-null with an if statement like this. The not equal operator, exclamation mark, double equals, compares O to null and evaluates to either true or false. But you can omit the comparison and instead rely on the fact that null is falsy and objects are truthy. In the first case, the body of the if will be executed only if O is not null. The second case is less strict. It will execute the body of the if only if O is not false or any falsy value, such as null or undefined. Which if statement is appropriate for your program really depends on what values you expect to be assigned to O. If you need to distinguish null from zero and double quotation marks, then you should use an explicit comparison. Boolean values have a toString method that you can use to convert them to the strings true or false, but they do not have any other useful methods. Despite the trivial API, there are three important Boolean operators. The double ampersand operator performs the Boolean AND operation. It evaluates to a truthy value if and only if both of its operands are truthy. It evaluates to a falsy value otherwise. The double vertical bar operator is the Boolean OR operation. It evaluates to a truthy value if either one or both of its operands is truthy, and evaluates to a falsy value if both operands are falsy. Finally, the unary exclamation mark operator performs the Boolean NOT operation. It evaluates to true if its operand is falsy and evaluates to false if its operand is truthy. For example, full details on these operators are in section 4.10. 3.5. Null and undefined. Null is a language keyword that evaluates to a special value that is usually used to indicate the absence of a value. Using the typeOf operator on null returns the string object, indicating that null can be thought of as a special object value that indicates no object. In practice, however, null is typically regarded as the sole member of its own type, and it can be used to indicate no value for numbers and strings as well as objects. Most programming languages have an equivalent to JavaScript's null. You may be familiar with it as all caps null, nil, or none. JavaScript also has a second value that indicates absence of value. The undefined value represents a deeper kind of absence. It is the value of variables that have not been initialized, and the value you get when you query the value of an object property or array element that does not exist. The undefined value is also the return value of functions that do not explicitly return a value, and the value of function parameters for which no argument is passed. Undefined is a predefined global constant, not a language keyword like null, though this is not an important distinction in practice, that is initialized to the undefined value. If you apply the typeOf operator to the undefined value, it returns undefined, indicating that this value is the sole member of a special type. Despite these differences, null and undefined both indicate an absence of value and can often be used interchangeably. The equality operator, double equals, considers them to be equal. Use the strict equality operator, triple equals, to distinguish them. Both are falsy values. They behave like false when a Boolean value is required. Neither null nor undefined have any properties or methods. In fact, using dot or square brackets to access a property or method of these values causes a type error. I consider undefined to represent a system-level, unexpected, or error-like absence of value, and null to represent a program-level, normal, or expected absence of value. I avoid using null and undefined when I can, but if I need to assign one of these values to a variable or property, or pass or return one of these values to or from a function, I usually use null. Some programmers strive to avoid null entirely and use undefined in its place wherever they can. 3.6. Symbols. Symbols were introduced in ES6 to serve as non-string property names. To understand symbols, you need to know that JavaScript's fundamental object type is an unordered collection of properties, where each property has a name and a value. Property names are typically, and until ES6 were exclusively, strings. But in ES6 and later, symbols can also serve this purpose. The symbol type does not have a literal syntax. To obtain a symbol value, you call the symbol function. This function never returns the same value twice, even when called with the same argument. This means that if you call symbol to obtain a symbol value, you can safely use that value as a property name to add a new property to an object and do not need to worry that you might be overwriting an existing property with the same name. Similarly, if you use symbolic property names and do not share those symbols, you can be confident that other modules of code in your program will not accidentally overwrite your properties. In practice, symbols serve as a language extension mechanism. When ES6 introduced the for of loop, section 5.4.4, and iterable objects, chapter 12, it needed to define standard method that classes could implement to make themselves iterable. But standardizing any particular string name for this iterator method would have broken existing code, so a symbolic name was used instead. As we'll discuss in chapter 12, symbol.iterator is a symbol value that can be used as a method name to make an object iterable. The symbol function takes an optional string argument and returns a unique symbol value. If you supply a string argument, that string will be included in the output of the symbols.toString method. Note, however, that calling symbol twice with the same string produces two completely different symbol values. ToString is the only interesting method of symbol instances. There are two other symbol-related functions you should know about, however. Sometimes, when using symbols, you want to keep them private to your own code, so you have a guarantee that your properties will never conflict with properties used by other code. Other times, however, you might want to define a symbol value and share it widely with other code. This would be the case, for example, if you were defining some kind of extension that you wanted other code to be able to participate in, as with the symbol.iterator mechanism described earlier. To serve this latter use case, JavaScript defines a global system registry. The symbol.for function takes a string argument and returns a symbol value that is associated with the string you pass. If no symbol is already associated with that string, then a new one is created and returned. Otherwise, the already existing symbol is returned. That is, the symbol.for function is completely different than the symbol function. Symbol never returns the same value twice, but symbol.for always returns the same value when called with the same string. The string passed to symbol.for appears in the output of toString for the returned symbol, and it can also be retrieved by calling symbol.keyfor on the returned symbol. 3.7. The global object. The preceding sections have explained JavaScript's primitive types and values. Object types, objects, arrays, and functions are covered in chapters of their own later in this book. But there is one very important object value that we must cover now. The global object is a regular JavaScript object that serves a very important purpose. The properties of this object are the globally defined identifiers that are available to a JavaScript program. When the JavaScript interpreter starts, or whenever a web browser loads a new page, it creates a new global object and gives it an initial set of properties that define global constants like undefined, infinity, and nan, global functions like isNan, parseInt, section 3.9.2, and eval, section 4.12. Constructor functions like date, regexp, string, object, and array, section 3.9.2. Global objects like math and JSON, section 6.8. The initial properties of the global object are not reserved words, but they deserve to be treated as if they are. This chapter has already described some of these global properties. Most of the others will be covered elsewhere in this book. In Node, the global object has a property named global, whose value is the global object itself. So you can always refer to the global object by the name global in Node programs. In web browsers, the window object serves as the global object for all JavaScript code contained in the browser window it represents. This global window object has a self-referential window property that can be used to refer to the global object. The window object defines the core global properties, but it also defines quite a few other globals that are specific to web browsers and client-side JavaScript. Web worker threads, section 15.13, have a different global object than the window with which they are associated. Code in a worker can refer to its global object as self. ES 2020 finally defines global this as the standard way to refer to the global object in any context. As of early 2020, this feature has been implemented by all modern browsers and by Node. 3.8. Immutable primitive values and mutable object references. There is a fundamental difference in JavaScript between primitive values, undefined, null, booleans, numbers, and strings, and objects, including arrays and functions. Primitives are immutable. There is no way to change or mutate a primitive value. This is obvious for numbers and booleans. It doesn't even make sense to change the value of a number. It is not so obvious for strings, however. Since strings are like arrays of characters, you might expect to be able to alter the character at any specified index. In fact, JavaScript does not allow this, and all string methods that appear to return a modified string are, in fact, returning a new string value. For example, primitives are also compared by value. Two values are the same only if they have the same value. This sounds circular for numbers, booleans, null, and undefined. There is no other way that they could be compared. Again, however, it is not so obvious for strings. If two distinct string values are compared, JavaScript treats them as equal if, and only if, they have the same length and if the character at each index is the same. Objects are different than primitives. First, they are mutable. Their values can change. Objects are not compared by value. Two distinct objects are not equal even if they have the same properties and values. And two distinct arrays are not equal even if they have the same elements in the same order. Objects are sometimes called reference types to distinguish them from JavaScript's primitive types. Using this terminology, object values are references, and we say that objects are compared by reference. Two object values are the same if and only if they refer to the same underlying object. As you can tell from this code, Assigning an object, or array, to a variable simply assigns the reference. It does not create a new copy of the object. If you want to make a new copy of an object or array, you must explicitly copy the properties of the object or the elements of the array. This example demonstrates using a for loop, section 5.4.3. Similarly, if we want to compare two distinct objects or arrays, we must compare their properties or elements. This code defines a function to compare two arrays. 3.9. Type conversions. JavaScript is very flexible about the types of values it requires. Booleans is an example of this. When JavaScript expects a Boolean value, you may supply a value of any type, and JavaScript will convert it as needed. Some values, truthy values, convert to true, and others, falsy values, convert to false. The same is true for other types. If JavaScript wants a string, it will convert whatever value you give it to a string. If JavaScript wants a number, it will try to convert the value you give it to a number, or to NaN if it cannot perform a meaningful conversion. Some examples. Table 3-2, which can be found in the accompanying bonus material, summarizes how values convert from one type to another in JavaScript. Bold entries in the table highlight conversions that you may find surprising. Empty cells indicate that no conversion is necessary and none is performed. The primitive-to-primitive conversions in the table are relatively straightforward. Conversion to Boolean was already discussed in section 3.4. Conversion to strings is well-defined for all primitive values. Conversion to numbers is just a little trickier. Strings that can be parsed as numbers convert to those numbers. Leading and trailing spaces are allowed. But any leading or trailing non-space characters that are not part of a numeric literal cause the string-to-number conversion to produce NaN. Some numeric conversions may seem surprising. True converts to 1, and false and the empty string convert to 0. Object-to-primitive conversion is somewhat more complicated, and it is the subject of section 3.9.3. 3.9.1. Conversions and equality. JavaScript has two operators that test whether two values are equal. The strict equality operator, triple equals, does not consider its operands to be equal if they are not of the same type, and this is almost always the right operator to use when coding. But because JavaScript is so flexible with type conversions, it also defines the double equals operator with a flexible definition of equality. All of the next comparisons are true, for example. Section 4.9.1 explains exactly what conversions are performed by the double equals operator in order to determine whether two values should be considered equal. Keep in mind that convertibility of one value to another does not imply equality of those two values. If undefined is used where a Boolean value is expected, for example, it will convert to false. But this does not mean that undefined, double equals, false. JavaScript operators and statements expect values of various types and perform conversions to those types. The if statement converts undefined to false. But the double equals operator never attempts to convert its operands to Booleans. 3.9.2. Explicit conversions. Although JavaScript performs many type conversions automatically, you may sometimes need to perform an explicit conversion, or you may prefer to make the conversions explicit to keep your code cleaner. The simplest way to perform an explicit type conversion is to use the Boolean, number, and string functions. Any value other than null or undefined has a toString method, and the result of this method is usually the same as that returned by the string function. As an aside, note that the Boolean, number, and string functions can also be invoked with new as constructor. If you use them this way, you'll get a wrapper object that behaves just like a primitive Boolean, number, or string value. These wrapper objects are a historical leftover from the earliest days of JavaScript, and there's never really any good reason to use them. Certain JavaScript operators perform implicit type conversions and are sometimes used explicitly for the purpose of type conversion. If one operand of the plus sign operator is a string, it converts the other one to a string. The unary plus sign operator converts its operand to a number, and the unary exclamation mark operator converts its operand to a Boolean and negates it. These facts lead to the next type conversion idioms that you may see in some code. Formatting and parsing numbers are common tasks in computer programs, and JavaScript has specialized functions and methods that provide more precise control over number-to-string and string-to-number conversions. The toString method defined by the number class accepts an optional argument that specifies a radix, or base, for the conversion. If you do not specify the argument, the conversion is done in base 10. However, you can also convert numbers in other bases, between 2 and 36. For example, when working with financial or scientific data, you may want to convert numbers to strings in ways that give you control over the number of decimal places or the number of significant digits in the output, or you may want to control whether exponential notation is used. The number class defines three methods for these kinds of number-to-string conversions. ToFixed converts a number to a string with a specified number of digits after the decimal point. It never uses exponential notation. ToExponential converts a number to a string using exponential notation with one digit before the decimal point and a specified number of digits after the decimal point, which means that the number of significant digits is one larger than the value you specify. ToPrecision converts a number to a string with the number of significant digits you specify. It uses exponential notation if the number of significant digits is not large enough to display the entire integer portion of the number. Note that all three methods round the trailing digits or pad with zeros as appropriate. Consider these examples. In addition to the number formatting methods here, the intl.numberformat class defines a more general, internationalized number formatting method. See section 11.7.1 for details. If you pass a string to the number conversion function, it attempts to parse that string as an integer or floating point literal. That function only works for base 10 integers and does not allow trailing characters that are not part of the literal. The parseInt and parseFloat functions, these are global functions, not methods of any class, are more flexible. ParseInt parses only integers, while parseFloat parses both integers and floating point numbers. If a string begins with 0x or 0 capital X, parseInt interprets it as a hexadecimal number. Both parseInt and parseFloat skip leading whitespace, parse as many numeric characters as they can, and ignore anything that follows. If the first non-space character is not part of a valid numeric literal, they return nan. ParseInt accepts an optional second argument specifying the radix, base, of the number to be parsed. Legal values are between 2 and 36. For example, 3.9.3, object to primitive conversions. The previous sections have explained how you can explicitly convert values of one type to another type and have explained JavaScript's implicit conversions of values from one primitive type to another primitive type. This section covers the complicated rules that JavaScript uses to convert objects to primitive values. It is long and obscure, and if this is your first time listening to this chapter, you should feel free to skip ahead to section 3.10. One reason for the complexity of JavaScript's object-to-primitive conversions is that some types of objects have more than one primitive representation. Date objects, for example, can be represented as strings or as numeric timestamps. The JavaScript specification defines three fundamental algorithms for converting objects to primitive values. Prefer string. This algorithm returns a primitive value, preferring a string value if a conversion to string is possible. Prefer number. This algorithm returns a primitive value, preferring a number if such a conversion is possible. No preference. This algorithm expresses no preference about what type of primitive value is desired, and classes can define their own conversions. Of the built-in JavaScript types, all except date implement this algorithm as prefer number. The date class implements this algorithm as prefer string. The implementation of these object-to-primitive conversion algorithms is explained at the end of this section. First, however, we explain how the algorithms are used in JavaScript. Object-to-Boolean conversions. Object-to-Boolean conversions are trivial. All objects convert to true. Notice that this conversion does not require the use of the object-to-primitive algorithms described, and that it literally applies to all objects, including empty arrays and even the wrapper object, new Boolean, false. Object-to-string conversions. When an object needs to be converted to a string, JavaScript first converts it to a primitive using the preferString algorithm, then converts the resulting primitive value to a string, if necessary, following the rules in Table 3-2. This kind of conversion happens, for example, if you pass an object to a built-in function that expects a string argument, if you call string as a conversion function, and when you interpolate objects into template literals. Section 3.3.4. Object-to-number conversions. When an object needs to be converted to a number, JavaScript first converts it to a primitive value using the preferNumber algorithm, then converts the resulting primitive value to a number, if necessary, following the rules in Table 3-2. Built-in JavaScript functions and methods that expect numeric arguments convert object arguments to numbers in this way, and most JavaScript operators that expect numeric operands convert objects to numbers in this way as well. Special case operator conversions. Operators are covered in detail in Chapter 4. Here, we will explain the special case operators that do not use the basic object-to-string and object-to-number conversions described earlier. The plus sign operator in JavaScript performs numeric addition and string concatenation. If either of its operands is an object, JavaScript converts them to primitive values using the no-preference algorithm. Once it has two primitive values, it checks their types. If either argument is a string, it converts the other to a string and concatenates the strings. Otherwise, it converts both arguments to numbers and adds them. The double equals and exclamation mark equals operators perform equality and inequality testing in a loose way that allows type conversions. If one operand is an object and the other is a primitive value, these operators convert the object to primitive using the no-preference algorithm and then compare the two primitive values. Finally, the relational operators, less than sign equals, greater than sign, and greater than sign equals, compare the order of their operands and can be used to compare both numbers and strings. If either operand is an object, it is converted to a primitive value using the preferNumber algorithm. Note, however, that unlike the object-to-number conversion, the primitive values returned by the prefer-number conversion are not then converted to numbers. Note that the numeric representation of date objects is meaningfully comparable with less than sign and greater than sign, but the string representation is not. For date objects, the no-preference algorithm converts to a string, so the fact that JavaScript uses the prefer-number algorithm for these operators means that we can use them to compare the order of two date objects. The toString and valueOf methods. All objects inherit two conversion methods that are used by object-to-primitive conversions. And before we can explain the prefer-string, prefer-number, and no-preference conversion algorithms, we have to explain these two methods. The first method is toString, and its job is to return a string representation of the object. The default toString method does not return a very interesting value, though we'll find it useful in section 14.4.3. Many classes define more specific versions of the toString method. The toString method of the array class, for example, converts each array element to a string and joins the resulting strings together with commas in between. The toString method of the function class converts user-defined functions to strings of JavaScript source code. The date class defines a toString method that returns a human-readable and JavaScript-parsable date and time string. The regexp class defines a toString method that converts regexp objects to a string that looks like a regexp literal. The other object conversion function is called valueOf. The job of this method is less well-defined. It is supposed to convert an object to a primitive value that represents the object, if any such primitive value exists. Objects are compound values, and most objects cannot really be represented by a single primitive value, so the default valueOf method simply returns the object itself rather than returning a primitive. Wrapper classes such as string, number, and boolean define valueOf methods that simply return the wrapped primitive value. Arrays, functions, and regular expressions simply inherit the default method. Calling valueOf for instances of these types simply returns the object itself. The date class defines a valueOf method that returns the date in its internal representation, the number of milliseconds since January 1, 1970. Object-to-primitive conversion algorithms. With the toString and valueOf methods explained, we can now explain approximately how the three object-to-primitive algorithms work. The complete details are deferred until section 14.4.7. The prefer-string algorithm first tries the toString method. If the method is defined and returns a primitive value, then JavaScript uses that primitive value, even if it is not a string. If toString does not exist, or if it returns an object, then JavaScript tries the valueOf method. If that method exists and returns a primitive value, then JavaScript uses that value. Otherwise, the conversion fails with a type error. The prefer-number algorithm works like the prefer-string algorithm, except that it tries valueOf first and toString second. The no-preference algorithm depends on the class of the object being converted. If the object is a date object, then JavaScript uses the prefer-string algorithm. For any other object, JavaScript uses the prefer-number algorithm. The rules described here are true for all built-in JavaScript types and are the default rules for any classes you define yourself. Section 14.4.7 explains how you can define your own object-to-primitive conversion algorithms for the classes you define. Before we leave this topic, It is worth noting that the details of the prefer number conversion explain why empty arrays convert to the number 0 and single element arrays can also convert to numbers. The object-to-number conversion first converts the object to a primitive using the prefer number algorithm, then converts the resulting primitive value to a number. The prefer number algorithm tries value of first and then falls back on to string. But the array class inherits the default value of method, which does not return a primitive value. So when we try to convert an array to a number, we end up invoking the toString method of the array. Empty arrays convert to the empty string, and the empty string converts to the number 0. An array with a single element converts to the same string that that one element does. If an array contains a single number, that number is converted to a string and then back to a number. 3.10. Variable declaration and assignment. One of the most fundamental techniques of computer programming is the use of names, or identifiers, to represent values. Binding a name to a value gives us a way to refer to that value and use it in the programs we write. When we do this, we typically say that we are assigning a value to a variable. The term variable implies that new values can be assigned, that the value associated with the variable may vary as our program runs. If we permanently assign a value to a name, then we call that name a constant instead of a variable. Before you can use a variable or constant in a JavaScript program, you must declare it. In ES6 and later, this is done with the let and const keywords, which we explain next. Prior to ES6, variables were declared with var, which is more idiosyncratic and is explained later on in this section. 3.10.1. Declarations with let and const. In modern JavaScript, ES6 and later, variables are declared with the let keyword, like this. You can also declare multiple variables in a single let statement. It is a good programming practice to assign an initial value to your variables when you declare them, when this is possible. If you don't specify an initial value for a variable with the let statement, the variable is declared, but its value is undefined until your code assigns a value to it. To declare a constant instead of a variable, use const instead of let. Const works just like let, except that you must initialize the constant when you declare it. As the name implies, constants cannot have their values changed, and any attempt to do so causes a type error to be thrown. It is a common, but not universal, convention to declare constants using names with all capital letters, such as capital H 0 or all caps http://not_found as a way to distinguish them from variables. Note: when to use const. There are two schools of thought about the use of the const keyword. One approach is to use const only for values that are fundamentally unchanging, like the physical constants shown, or program version numbers, or byte sequences used to identify file types, for example. Another approach recognizes that many of the so-called variables in our program don't actually ever change as our program runs. In this approach, we declare everything with const, and then if we find that we do actually want to allow the value to vary, we switch the declaration to let. This may help prevent bugs by ruling out accidental changes to variables that we did not intend. In one approach, we use const only for values that must not change. In the other, we use const for any value that does not happen to change. I prefer the former approach in my own code. In Chapter 5, we'll learn about the for in, and for of loop statements in JavaScript. Each of these loops includes a loop variable that gets a new value assigned to it on each iteration of the loop. JavaScript allows us to declare the loop variable as part of a loop syntax itself, and this is another common way to use let. It may seem surprising, but you can also use const to declare the loop variables for in and for of loops, as long as the body of the loop does not reassign a new value. In this case, the const declaration is just saying that the value is constant for the duration of one loop iteration. Variable and constant scope. The scope of a variable is the region of your program source code in which it is defined. Variables and constants declared with let and const are block scoped. This means that they are only defined within the block of code in which the let or const statement appears. JavaScript class and function definitions are blocks, and so are the bodies of if-else statements, while loops, for loops, and so on. Roughly speaking, if a variable or constant is declared within a set of curly braces, then those curly braces delimit the region of code in which the variable or constant is defined. Though, of course, it is not legal to reference a variable or constant from lines of code that execute before the let or const statement that declares the variable. Variables and constants declared as part of for in, or for of loop have the loop body as their scope, even though they technically appear outside of the curly braces. When a declaration appears at the top level, outside of any code blocks, we say it is a global variable or constant and has global scope. In Node and in client-side JavaScript modules, the scope of a global variable is the file that it is defined in. In traditional client-side JavaScript, however, the scope of a global variable is the HTML document in which it is defined. That is, if one script declares a global variable or constant, that variable or constant is defined in all of the script elements in that document, or at least all the scripts that execute after the let or const statement executes. Repeated declarations. It is a syntax error to use the same name with more than one let or const declaration in the same scope. It is legal, though a practice best avoided, to declare a new variable with the same name in a nested scope. Declarations and types. If you're used to statically typed languages, such as C or Java, you may think that the primary purpose of variable declarations is to specify the type of values that may be assigned to a variable. But, as you have learned, there is no type associated with JavaScript's variable declarations. There are JavaScript extensions, such as TypeScript and Flow, section 17.8, that allow types to be specified as part of variable declarations with syntax like let x, colon, number, equals, 0, semicolon. A JavaScript variable can hold a value of any type. For example, it is perfectly legal, but generally poor programming style, in JavaScript to assign a number to a variable and then later assign a string to that variable. 3.10.2. Variable declarations with var. In versions of JavaScript before ES6, the only way to declare a variable is with the var keyword, and there is no way to declare constants. The syntax of var is just like the syntax of let. Although var and let have the same syntax, there are important differences in the way they work. Variables declared with var do not have block scope. Instead, they are scoped to the body of the containing function, no matter how deeply nested they are inside that function. If you use var outside of a function body, it declares a global variable. But global variables declared with var differ from globals declared with let in an important way. Globals declared with var are implemented as properties of the global object, section 3.7. The global object can be referenced as global this. So if you write var x equals 2 semicolon outside of a function, it is like you wrote global this dot x equals 2 semicolon. Note, however, that the analogy is not perfect. The properties created with global var declarations cannot be deleted with the delete operator, section 4.13.4. Global variables and constants declared with let and const are not properties of the global object. Unlike variables declared with let, it is legal to declare the same variable multiple times with var. And because var variables have function scope instead of block scope, it is actually common to do this kind of redeclaration. The variable I is frequently used for integer values, and especially as the index variable of for loops. In a function with multiple for loops, it is typical for each one to begin for open parenthesis var I equals 0 semicolon triple dot. Because var does not scope these variables to the loop body, each of these loops is, harmlessly, redeclaring and reinitializing the same variable. One of the most unusual features of var declarations is known as hoisting. When a variable is declared with var, the declaration is lifted up, or hoisted, to the top of the enclosing function. The initialization of the variable remains where you wrote it, but the definition of the variable moves to the top of the function. So variables declared with var can be used, without error, anywhere in the enclosing function. If the initialization code has not run yet, then the value of the variable may be undefined, but you won't get an error if you use the variable before it is initialized. This can be a source of bugs and is one of the important misfeatures that let corrects. If you declare a variable with let but attempt to use it before the let statement runs, you will get an actual error instead of just seeing an undefined value. Note: using undeclared variables. In strict mode, section 5.6.3, if you attempt to use an undeclared variable, you will get a reference error when you run your code. Outside of strict mode, however, if you assign a value to a name that has not been declared with let, const, or var, you'll end up creating a new global variable. It will be a global no matter how deeply nested within functions and blocks your code is, which is almost certainly not what you want, is bug-prone, and is one of the best reasons for using strict mode. Global variables created in this accidental way are like global variables declared with var. They define properties of the global object. But unlike the properties defined by proper var declarations, these properties can be deleted with the delete operator, section 4.13.4. 3.10.3. Destructuring assignment. ES6 implements a kind of compound declaration and assignment syntax known as destructuring assignment. In a destructuring assignment, the value on the right-hand side of the equals sign is an array or object, a structured value, and the left-hand side specifies one or more variable names using a syntax that mimics array and object literal syntax. When a destructuring assignment occurs, one or more values are extracted, destructured, from the value on the right and stored into the variables named on the left. Destructuring assignment is perhaps most commonly used to initialize variables as part of a const, let, or var declaration statement, but it can also be done in regular assignment expressions with variables that have already been declared. And, as we'll learn about in section 8.3.5, destructuring can also be used when defining the parameters to a function. Here are some destructuring assignments using arrays of values. Notice how destructuring assignment makes it easy to work with functions that return arrays of values. We learned that variables and constants can be declared as part of JavaScript's various for loops. It is possible to use variable destructuring in this context as well. Here is a code that loops over the name/value pairs of all properties of an object and uses destructuring assignment to convert those pairs from two-element arrays into individual variables. The number of variables on the left of a destructuring assignment does not have to match the number of array elements on the right. Extra variables on the left are set to undefined, and extra values on the right are ignored. The list of variables on the left can include extra commas to skip certain values on the right. If you want to collect all unused or remaining values into a single variable when destructuring an array, use three dots before the last variable name on the left-hand side. Three dots will be used this way again in section 8.3.2, where they are used to indicate that all remaining function arguments should be collected into a single array. Destructuring assignment can be used with nested arrays. In this case, the left-hand side of the assignment should look like a nested array literal. A powerful feature of array destructuring is that it does not actually require an array. You can use any iterable object, chapter 12, on the right-hand side of the assignment, any object that can be used for a for of loop, section 5.4.4, can also be destructured. Destructuring assignment can also be performed when the right-hand side is an object value. In this case, the left-hand side of the assignment looks something like an object literal, a comma-separated list of variable names within curly braces. The next example copies global functions of the math object into variables, which might simplify code that does a lot of trigonometry. Notice in the code here that the math object has many properties other than the three that are destructured into individual variables. Those that are not named are simply ignored. If the left-hand side of this assignment had included a variable whose name was not a property of math, that variable would simply be assigned undefined. In each of these object destructuring examples, we have chosen variable names that match the property names of the object we're destructuring. This keeps the syntax simple and easy to understand, but it is not required. Each of the identifiers on the left-hand side of an object destructuring assignment can also be a colon-separated pair of identifiers, where the first is the name of the property whose value is to be assigned, and the second is the name of the variable to assign it to. I find that object destructuring syntax becomes too complicated to be useful when the variable names and property names are not the same, and I tend to avoid the shorthand in this case. If you choose to use it, remember that property names are always on the left of the colon, in both object literals and on the left of an object destructuring assignment. Destructuring assignment becomes even more complicated when it is used with nested objects, or arrays of objects, or objects of arrays, but it is legal. Or, instead of destructuring an array of objects, we could destructure an object of arrays. Complex destructuring syntax like this can be hard to write and hard to read, and you may be better off just writing out your assignments explicitly with traditional code, like let x1 equal points.p1 open square bracket 0 close square bracket semicolon. Understanding complex destructuring. If you find yourself working with code that uses complex destructuring assignments, there is a useful regularity that can help you make sense of the complex cases. Think first about a regular, single-value assignment. After the assignment is done, you can take the variable name from the left-hand side of the assignment and use it as an expression in your code, where it will evaluate to whatever value you assigned it. The same thing is true for destructuring assignment. The left-hand side of a destructuring assignment looks like an array literal or an object literal, section 6.2.1 and section 6.10. After the assignment has been done, the left-hand side will actually work as a valid array literal or object literal elsewhere in your code. You can check that you've written a destructuring assignment correctly by trying to use the left-hand side on the right-hand side of another assignment expression. 3.11. Summary. Some key points to remember about this chapter. How to write and manipulate numbers and strings of text in JavaScript. How to work with JavaScript's other primitive types, booleans, symbols, null, and undefined. The differences between immutable primitive types and mutable reference types. How JavaScript converts values implicitly from one type to another, and how you can do so explicitly in your programs. How to declare and initialize constants and variables, including with destructuring assignment, and the lexical scope of the variables and constants you declare. Chapter 4. Expressions and Operators. This chapter documents JavaScript expressions and the operators with which many of those expressions are built. An expression is a phrase of JavaScript that can be evaluated to produce a value. A constant embedded literally in your program is a very simple kind of expression. A variable name is also a simple expression that evaluates to whatever value has been assigned to that variable. Complex expressions are built from simpler expressions. An array access expression, for example, consists of one expression that evaluates to an array, followed by an open square bracket, an expression that evaluates to an integer, and a closed square bracket. This new, more complex expression evaluates to the value stored at the specified index of the specified array. Similarly, a function invocation expression consists of one expression that evaluates to a function object and zero or more additional expressions that are used as the arguments to the function. The most common way to build a complex expression out of simpler expressions is with an operator. An operator combines the values of its operands, usually two of them, in some way and evaluates to a new value. The multiplication operator asterisk is a simple example. The expression x asterisk y evaluates to the product of the values of the expressions x and y. For simplicity, we sometimes say that an operator returns a value rather than evaluates to a value. This chapter documents all of JavaScript's operators, and it also explains expressions, such as array indexing and function invocation, that do not use operators. If you already know another programming language that uses C-style syntax, you'll find that the syntax of most of JavaScript's expressions and operators is already familiar to you. 4.1. Primary Expressions. The simplest expressions, known as primary expressions, are those that stand alone. They do not include any simpler expressions. Primary expressions in JavaScript are constant or literal values, certain language keywords, and variable references. Literals are constant values that are embedded directly in your program. They look like these. JavaScript syntax for number literals was covered in section 3.2. String literals were documented in section 3.3. The regular expression literal syntax was introduced in section 3.3.5 and will be documented in detail in section 11.3. Some of JavaScript's reserved words are primary expressions. We learned about true, false, and null in section 3.4 and 3.5. Unlike the other keywords, this is not a constant. It evaluates to different values in different places in the program. The this keyword is used in object-oriented programming. Within the body of a method, this evaluates to the object on which the method was invoked. See Section 4.5, Chapter 8, especially Section 8.2.2, and Chapter 9 for more on this. Finally, the third type of primary expression is a reference to a variable, constant, or property of the global object. When any identifier appears by itself in a program, JavaScript assumes it is a variable or constant or property of the global object and looks up its value. If no variable with that name exists, an attempt to evaluate a non-existent variable throws a reference error instead. 4.2. Object and Array Initializers. Object and array initializers are expressions whose value is a newly created object or array. These initializer expressions are sometimes called object literals and array literals. Unlike true literals, however, they are not primary expressions because they include a number of sub-expressions that specify property and element values. Array initializers have a slightly simpler syntax, and we'll begin with those. An array initializer is a comma-separated list of expressions contained within square brackets. The value of an array initializer is a newly created array. The elements of this new array are initialized to the values of the comma-separated expressions. The element expressions in an array initializer can themselves be array initializers, which means that these expressions can create nested arrays. The element expressions in an array initializer are evaluated each time the array initializer is evaluated. This means that the value of an array initializer expression may be different each time it is evaluated. Undefined elements can be included in an array literal by simply omitting a value between commas. For example, this array contains 5 elements, including 3 undefined elements. A single trailing comma is allowed after the last expression in an array initializer and does not create an unidentified element. However, any array access expression for an index after that of the last expression will necessarily evaluate to undefined. Object initializer expressions are like array initializer expressions, but the square brackets are replaced by curly brackets, and each sub-expression is prefixed with a property name and a colon. In ES6, object literals have a much more feature-rich syntax. You can find details in section 6.10. Object literals can be nested. For example, we'll discuss object and array initializers again in chapters 6 and 7. 4.3. Function definition expressions. A function definition expression defines a JavaScript function, and the value of such an expression is the newly defined function. In a sense, a function definition expression is a function literal, in the same way that an object initializer is an object literal. A function definition expression typically consists of the keyword function followed by a comma-separated list of 0 or more identifiers, the parameter names, in parentheses, and a block of JavaScript code, the function body, in curly braces. For example, a function definition expression can also include a name for the function. Functions can also be defined using a function statement rather than a function expression. And in ES6 and later, function expressions can use a compact new arrow function syntax. Complete details on function definition are in Chapter 8. 4.4. Property access expressions. A property access expression evaluates to the value of an object property or an array element. JavaScript defines two syntaxes for property access. The first style of property access is an expression followed by a period and an identifier. The expression specifies the object, and the identifier specifies the name of the desired property. The second style of property access follows the first expression, the object or array, with another expression in square brackets. This second expression specifies the name of the desired property or the index of the desired array element. Here are some concrete examples. With either type of property access expression, the expression before the dot or open square bracket is first evaluated. If the value is null or undefined, the expression throws a type error, since these are the two JavaScript values that cannot have properties. If the object expression is followed by a dot and an identifier, the value of the property named by that identifier is looked up and becomes the overall value of the expression. If the object expression is followed by another expression in square brackets, that second expression is evaluated and converted to a string. The overall value of the expression is then the value of the property named by that string. In either case, if the named property does not exist, then the value of the property access expression is undefined. The dot identifier syntax is the simpler of the two property access options, but notice that it can only be used when the property you want to access has a name that is a legal identifier and when you know the name when you write the program. If the property name includes spaces or punctuation characters, or when it is a number for arrays, you must use the square bracket notation. Square brackets are also used when the property name is not static, but is itself the result of a computation. Objects and their properties are covered in detail in Chapter 6, and arrays and their elements are covered in Chapter 7. 4.4.1 Conditional Property Access. ES 2020 adds two new kinds of property access expressions. In JavaScript, the values null and undefined are the only two values that do not have properties. In a regular property access expression using dot or square brackets, you get a type error if the expression on the left evaluates to null or undefined. You can use question mark dot and question mark dot square brackets syntax to guard against errors of this type. Consider the expression A question mark dot B. If A is null or undefined, then the expression evaluates to undefined without any attempt to access the property B. If A is some other value, then A question mark dot B evaluates to whatever A dot B would evaluate to, and if A does not have a property named B, then the value will again be undefined. This form of property access expression is sometimes called optional chaining because it also works for longer chained property access expressions like this one. A is an object, so A dot B is a valid property access expression. But the value of A dot B is null, so A dot B dot C.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.